Casadee Pope. I'm from West Palm Beach, Florida, and I sing in the band Hey Monday. I've always been into music. I started taking voice lessons when I was 4. So ever since then, I've kind of just known I wanted to be a singer, whether it be solo or in a band. And then around 13, I decided I wanted to be in bands. About 2008 is when Hey Monday joined together. In a private middle school. In high school, freshman year, I entered into a public school, and I definitely noticed people getting drunk and doing drugs and everything, and I had no idea about any of it. I wouldn't go to a lot of the parties, but when I did go, there was definitely peer pressure there. Everyone was drinking, everyone was smoking, and I always had those morals set since I was young, so I didn't really see the point in breaking them. Pretending, darling, that you'll ever come back. But it's too late, too late. There's a song on our album, Hold On Tight, that's about a group of friends that I had in high school, and then they gradually became more and more crazy with drugs and everything, and I had heard that they started doing coke, and I was just thinking to myself, man, I'm really happy I got out of that group of friends when I did, because there's no way I would ever be associated with that kind of stuff. I have to worry about waking up every day and singing every day and drinking every night would probably dry out my vocal cords and I would sound like a frog. So I don't want that. I don't want to be strung out. I want to have fun on tour. I want to be lively and young. I would absolutely not be able to perform at my fullest every day. Jumping around and singing and having to use my diaphragm and, you know, risking running out of breath, it's not worth it. So I stay away from it. I'll hang out and, you know, obviously people offer me things, but, you know, it's not a big pressure thing for me. I don't really care about doing that stuff. I'm Casadee and my natural high is singing.
I was born and raised in Annapolis, Maryland. My dad had a construction company, just was always riding anything with motor, building anything with motor, and we'd go down to Florida on the weekends for the winters because it got a little too cold here to ride motorcycles, but you know, it was definitely a full-time commitment, just having fun and trying to ride everything we could. I think for any kid, you know, starting 4, 5, 6, riding a dirt bike, they always just assume they're going to be a professional motocrosser. And you know, when I was 9, 10, 11, a lot of my friends started realizing that, you know, that dream wasn't a reality. And for me, reality just never really set in, and just kept passionate and kept focused. And everyone says, what's the key to making it a sport? And I'd say to have a passion for it. Or, you know, it doesn't have to be a sport. It could be it could be school. It could be anything. If you're passionate about what you do, you'll find a way to make it work. And I think that's just what I've always been.
He was really, really good on the bicycle and up and down the steps and just crazy on the bicycle from 2.5. He had a go-kart at 2.5, a bicycle at 3, and just rode it hard. And so we thought, you know, what can we challenge him with? And somebody said, a motorcycle.
For me, it was interesting because motocross is a sport where it's mostly athletes. Everyone works hard, everyone trains hard. No one that I knew really did drugs definitely no one even drank, really. Everyone was just focused on trying to get their body as healthy as possible. It wasn't possible to do both. You either wanted to be the best in your sport or you wanted to have fun. I believe talent is something that's earned. Talent is something that you gain from blood, sweat, and hard work along the way. It just seems like the guys that that work really hard, that are younger, that, you know, they gave up a lot of stuff to be who they were. You know, they didn't really have the childhood, they didn't have a lot of friends, they focused a lot on their sports, and when they get really good really fast and a lot of money starts coming in, and then, you know, they start getting into a different scene, and they're like, all of a sudden they're cool, and they never really been, you know, the guy that everyone was looking up to, and it's difficult to stay the road, stay the path, and remember how you got there and why you're on top. And that at that point you also have a responsibility to be a, you know, role model, someone other people look up to.
He was very aware that to land the right kind of sponsors, if you want to be an athlete and you want to be good at what you do, you have to put the sport first, and that never includes smoking cigarettes, alcohol. It never includes anything except just a good, clean life. That's who they want to see when they give you that sponsorship. So Travis was well aware of who he was supposed to be, and he did more than that. He made sure that the people, not only did they think he was that clean cut, he really was that clean cut.
There's always going to be options to take, you know, plan B, and you always see friends going down, you know, road, or maybe not friends, but acquaintances or people maybe you can look up to. And there's always, you have the option to be healthy, and that, you know, may mean staying away from drugs, staying away from alcohol. It may just mean waking up every morning before school and going for a run. You know, but you have to ask yourself, what are my goals in life? And I know that's something that, you know, a lot of kids say, oh, well, you know, I don't need to think that far ahead. But really, every action and everything that you do has a consequence and has a reaction. It's just something that I think is really important to realize. Where do you want to go and who do you want to be, not who everyone else wants you to be? And it's kind of thinking for yourself, I think, is a big part of why not to do drugs. My name is Travis Pastrana, and my natural high is following my passion.
I grew up in Laguna Beach, California. I spent a lot of time at the beach. I remember every summer I had to do junior lifeguards, which is awful. You're basically like little kids with six packs because you've been working out all summer. I loved clothes and I loved making things, and I used to sew with my little tiny sewing machine. So just from a very young age, it was just what I wanted to do, and because I'm stubborn, no one can tell me differently. The first time I can remember being aware of drug use around me is as early as sixth or seventh grade. In the beginning, I didn't really understand. I think that I was just still very young and didn't understand exactly what drugs were. There was just this group of kids who just did drugs all the time, and everyone knew it, and you're getting ready to go to college within a few years, and you're worried about your GPA and, you know, worried about your future. And I think that when you're so involved in drugs, you have such a lack of interest there, and you just don't really care about your future. After I graduated high school, I moved to San Francisco for a little while, went to the Academy of Art University there. Then I moved back and decided to move to LA to go to FITM. And once I got into LA, I wasn't just, you know, going to college, I was also involved in the entertainment industry, and I think that that was a point where I saw drug use at a whole new level. When you're in high school and, you know, you slip up and you get into drugs, you know, your grades drop, and that's awful. But when you're in Hollywood and you get into drugs and you don't show up for your call time and it gets out there that you're getting into bad things, like, that's your career, you know, that's your future. It's sad that people come and they have this bright future and they're so talented, and it's just, it's the same story over and over and over, and people don't really learn from it. I don't know if there was one specific thing that
you know, encouraged me not to do drugs. I just genuinely didn't want to do them. They didn't seem that cool to me, and they didn't look that fun. So I just never really had an interest. Even when I started filming the first show, I knew that my end goal was to end up in the fashion industry. I knew that I wanted a clothing line. I wanted to be involved with design. So through the show, I made a lot of relationships that helped me out until I kind of reached a point where it made sense to do, and I was able to do my first line. With fashion, it was just ever since I was little, this is what I want to do, this is what I'm going to do. Writing was an unexpected opportunity. So that was something where we got into it, and then I was like, I really love doing this. And then it came to the time where the book was released, and you know, nobody really knew what to expect. And then, you know, in that first week when I got the call that it was a number one bestseller, like, that's just not something you expect. My name is Lauren Conrad, and my natural high is getting to design beautiful clothing.
My name is Terry Kennedy. I'm from Long Beach, California, 25 years old. At the time when I was coming up, Long Beach was like any other city. And me saying that, any other inner city, like a Compton, a Watts, Long Beach, Inglewood, it's nothing but gang violence, drug selling, just the repercussions of an inner city. Just a lot of negativity. No positivity, no direction to really look in. Played on a junior high basketball and football team. Started point guard, I was eighth grade, and the shooting guard on my team was Hispanic. He skateboarded. So every day after school, after basketball practice and football practice, I see him in front of the school skating around. I remember just seeing his skate clothes and just like being fascinated by it. Like, dude, them are like the coolest shoes. Like, what kind of shoes are those? And I would bother him every day after basketball practice, every day. To the point he was just like, dude, won't you skate? And he's like, man, all right, because you might as well. Dude, you're going to continue to bother me about it, you might as well. So he was like, meet me at this park called Cherry Park. He was like, I'm going to bring you a board, just bring some skate shoes. I remember it was the first day of summer, went up to Cherry Park. Sure enough, Evan was there. I seen two other black kids that was on my team. I was stunned. They were skating. I'm like, y'all skate? They like, we just be playing basketball. It's nothing for us to sign. I mean, it ain't like you skated, so it's nothing for us to start a conversation to you about. And for sure enough, I come to this park, it was a whole other world. Like, I seen everybody getting along. It's blacks, Asians, Hispanics, Korean. Everybody is a melting pot of just all ethnicities. For us to be in a situation like that where all different races getting along and interacting, and not getting in trouble or trying to fight each other, I was like, wow. And then from there, I swear to God, I went to this park every day. Didn't miss a day. You know, like skateboarding, it was just something with skateboarding, it just like, it touched me. I was like, man, it's a peace of mind. It kept me away from my neighborhood. It kept me out of trouble for that moment. It's just like, it brought me to a new world. Like a new environment. I was like, dude, I'm not around a gang of negativity. Everybody getting along, we just having a good time. First time I heard drugs, I was probably about 10 when I first actually seen my mother actually do drugs. Couldn't wrap my head around it, like, what is this? And then actually seen my mom do it, and it just like freaked me out. It was like the scariest thing I ever saw. She was like the most loving, caring mom in the world, and then she'd do drugs, and then it's just like something would switch. It got to a crucial point to where my mom was so messed up on drugs to where she used to spend all our money to where I remember this. I was going to school. I was starting ninth grade. And I remember the first day of school, my mom been out. Like, she'd probably been gone for about 2 days at a time. So she was hungry, didn't have no food. And I remember her going to school with me, walking me to school the first day of school, and had to eat lunch and breakfast with me. Because she didn't have no money and smoked up all the money. And it was just like a devastating thing for me to be in high school and then people to know that my mom was on drugs, because they could tell. My mom was like just functioning differently. And just being in cafeteria with me trying to eat food and like just, cause she was just so messed up at that point. It was just like, the most gnarliest thing I had to endure. It's coming from Cherry Park. My friend Evan was giving me a ride home. My uncle called me and said, you gotta hurry home. You know, something drastic is happening in the family. And I'm like, you know, what's going on? You know, we'll tell you in the game. I'm like, nah, what, you know, what's going on? Like, I don't wanna walk in there. Like, what happened? They like, well, they found your mom passed away this morning. I remember this day too. A lot of you wanted to cry, but I remember not shedding a tear. I remember just hanging up the phone and being like, I knew it was coming. If I was doing drugs, would I be successful as I am today now? No, drugs take you away from who you are. My mom was a loving, caring person. When she did drugs, that light switch turned off. If I came up here being Terry Kennedy and on drugs, these kids would be more so probably embarrassed. And secondly, they wouldn't even probably want to be around. Because for one, I skateboard and I represent what they do, and they represent what I do. So if I'm doing drugs, I'm giving them a bad look, and that ain't the key. No one in a God's green earth was born in there, was like, as soon as you was born, the doctor was like, here goes cigarette, here go anything, here goes some weed. No, you was born into this world natural and healthy as possible. So why you can't live and continue to go about life like that? You was a happy boy, little child running around the same way. So I look at life like nothing changes, man, but you. You probably get a little bit taller, put on a little bit of weight, you know, get a deeper voice, whatever it may be. You go through hormone changes, but the world doesn't change. So the key is to stay true to you. I will say this, I'm gonna tell you how much of a main factor in life that this is to surround yourself around positive people and positive things that's going on. I had two choices. I could have stayed in my neighborhood and did what I did, or I could have stayed on the skateboard and continued to push past my neighborhood. The opportunities that my block would have handed me was either dead, in jail, or on drugs the rest of my life. You know, so I would say, surround yourself around people that's positive first. Secondly, be comfortable with who you are, secondly. And third of most all, have fun. That's the key, have fun. I'm Terry Kennedy, and my natural high is skateboarding.
Yeah, Steve and Eric, they had dreams. They were good athletes. They loved the outdoors. They loved the ocean, and they were smart. You know, they were loving life when we were growing up. They were just on a good path. You know, just really enjoying life. And they got sidetracked. They listened to some friends that turned out not to be very good friends, and they got them into drugs. And they thought drugs were cool. They thought drugs would lead to something that they didn't have. They thought they'd try to fit in and you know, kick it up a notch by doing drugs.
I remember running up my grandma's driveway to see him, and he would always be coming up from the garage, and he would greet me with a big hug, and I just remember how much I loved him.
Yeah, in high school, when Steve got addicted, you know, he thought he could experiment and get away with it, and he got addicted, and I knew this was going to be a rough road. I remember seeing Steve when he came home, and he just looked like a ghost. He was a big boy. He, you know, he was 200 pounds, 6'3", and to see him at 83 pounds, you know, it was like slowly watching my brother die. To see both my brothers addicted on drugs was just heavy. We came from having a normal family to just being out of control. You know, I didn't see him very much. They wouldn't come home for dinner. It was just all of a sudden the three musketeers, we used to call ourselves, wasn't the same. I remember sitting down with Steven and telling him if he didn't stop, he was gonna die.
He had seizures and was lying on the floor. And then I knew that this addiction would kill him.
I got a call in the middle of the night by a sheriff.
I remember the day that he was gone. I was running up the stairs to see him, and he didn't come up from the garage.
He was alone and got some more cocaine, and his heart couldn't take any more of it. He collapsed.
Fell to my knees and started crying. I couldn't believe that my little brother was gone. Just couldn't believe it.
I looked at my grandma, and she had her face in her hands, and he was gone. I was mad. I was angry. And mostly at him. You know, I was mad that he had left me for drugs, basically.
Stephen left behind a little girl. Stephen left behind a 5-year-old girl. I mean, drugs were so powerful. His daughter was more important to him than anything.
The drugs overpowered his love for me.
Eric, you know, he started smoking pot, which is a gateway drug, and it led to worse drugs. And he ended up taking some pretty strong drugs, and he ended up getting a full-blown depression, and he couldn't think straight. And Eric spent 8 years in a mental institution. The drugs changed Eric forever, and he was never the same. And when he got out, the poor young man was half the person he was when he went in, and couldn't pull it together.
He decided he wanted to get rid of the pain he was in. And so he went over to the Coronado Bridge and jumped.
My mom called me and she said she thinks that Eric jumped off the bridge. And a short time later, I found out that he did. My name is John Sunt. I'm from La Jolla, California, and the reason I produced this video and started the Natural High series is I lost my 2 little brothers to drugs. My motivation for this video is to teach every kid to get a natural high and choose a natural high over drugs.
I'm Casadee, and my natural high is singing.
My name is Travis Pastrana, and my natural high is following my passion.
My name is Lauren Conrad, and my natural high is getting to design beautiful clothing.
I'm Terry Kennedy, and my natural high is skateboarding.
My name is Allura. My natural highs are music, laughing, and activism, and I pledge to live naturally high.
Hi, my name is Rashad, and my natural high is skating, and I pledge to live naturally high.
My name is Laura. My natural high is playing soccer, and I pledge to live naturally high.
My name is Jessie. My natural highs are music and dance, and I pledge to live naturally high.
My name is Ryan. My natural high is lacrosse, and I pledge to live naturally high.
My name is Megan. My natural highs are soccer, volleyball, and writing, and I pledge to live naturally high.